Birthdays, holidays, promotions, there's a lot in this world worth celebrating. But nothing is worth celebrating more than knowledge that pays off. Like understanding how compound interest works, knowing how to check your investment professional's background, or figuring out your risk tolerance.
Or finally understanding those terms your friends throw around like ETF, ESG, and ICO. Learn about these investment products and more at investor.gov, your unbiased resource for valuable investment information, tools, and tips. Before you invest, investor.gov.
Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
Welcome, we're back.
It's the Bob and Sheri Show with Bob.
You are a delight.
And Sheri.
I am worshipped here.
And now, broadcasting from the Palatial Bob and Sheri Studios, it's Bob and Sheri.
Oh, you guys. One of the kids sent me a video that I think I've watched probably 8 times just since my alarm went off this morning. I don't know how I missed catching this and sending it to them first, but we've got a lot going on in the family with two brand new babies home from the hospital. This happened at an LA Dodgers game the other night. A fan ran onto the field and immediately was pursued by 5 or 6 uniformed security officers. And he got away from them. And I have video. I'm posting it on our Facebook, so you can go watch this right now. So you see this guy, and he's just getting it, man. He's just running across that field. And the security officers are coming at him from multiple directions. They can't catch him. Meanwhile, out in the outfield is the ball girl. And she's like a sorority girl at a college in Los Angeles. Her name is Marissa. She's movie star beautiful, by the way. Like, it's almost ridiculous how pretty this girl is, right?
Of course. It's Los Angeles, of course.
It's just like, this ball girl for the LA Dodgers would be the most beautiful woman who walked into any room you've ever been in. And there she is out there. And she's been doing the ball girl thing for a couple of years. Anyway, the guy is running across the field. The security officers are chasing him. The crowd is going wild. And you see this ball girl who's in uniform. You see her sort of assessing the situation and kind of bouncing a little bit on the balls of her feet, trying to calculate what direction the guy is coming in. The guy comes toward her. She tackles him and flips him over the barrier that separates the fans from the field.
You're kidding.
No, it's crazy.
Epic. It's so good.
Is she tall? Is she real strong looking? What's her physique like?
She looks like a tiny blonde Miss whatever. She's she's just a little bitty thing. And she just caught him and sent him flying. And of course, you know, the crowd goes wild. The video is so fun to watch.
So cool.
One of the kids texted me the video and said, "You can talk about this on your show. You're welcome." And I'm like, "Yeah, thank you. This is great. I'm going to put this on Facebook."
That's girl power right there.
It's
huh?
super
that's
fun.
That's great. You know, it's a funny thing. When you see somebody on a field, and usually it's a streaker, you say, "Oh, this is bad. This is not going to end well." On the one hand, part of your brain is saying, get that guy. He should not be doing that. This is disgusting. There are kids there. And the other part of your brain is going, go, man, go. So let's see if you can get away with it. Go, go, go.
The thing is, like, when you're watching the video, Max, you've seen it too,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I have.
So
yeah.
When you're watching the video, because it's taken, I've seen video from different angles. I've seen cell phone video from fans, and I've seen the Dodgers, like, I guess, stadium video. Mm-hmm. At that distance, that doesn't seem like he's going that fast, but he must have been just booking it.
Because he flew. He flew.
Yeah.
When she hit him, he flew.
I mean, when she took him out and sent him over the barricade, it didn't look like it even messed up her hair. It looked so effortless for her to do this to this guy.
She's going to get a movie contract out of that thing, you know? That's like Charlie Angel style, but the real thing. Good for her.
I went and I hunted her down because she's all over social media, right? So I hunted her down, and her socials are just pictures of her like in bikinis by pools and in her Dodgers uniform. Her jersey is number 93 and at the stadium. And I'm looking at her and I'm like, oh my God, this is so LA. It's like the song said, you know, there's that old, could it be Dionne Warwick? and all the stars that never were are parked cars. And
do you know the way to San Jose?
Yeah. Right. So like all these beautiful people flooded into Hollywood to make their dreams come true. Only a handful of them became stars. The rest met each other, fell in love, and started having the most beautiful babies the world has ever seen. And
well, you know,
and
every, who told us
every
that?
Third when we, person when, in LA is gorgeous, right?
Well, you know who told us that? I think it was, I don't think it was in person. I think it was when we had him on the show, Dick Clark. Dick Clark was the first person, I think, that told us that there are so many good-looking people there because of what you just said. You know, the best-looking man or the best-looking woman in, name the city in Kansas or wherever it may be, decided to go and take a shot. It didn't work out, but they stayed because the weather is nice. At least it was then. And then they had a family, and the kids looked beautiful because the two, you know, mother and father are gorgeous.
It's this, I could not get enough. After I saw the video, I was like, yes, girl. Then I started digging a little deeper and reading more about her. And it's just one of those moments, but it wasn't like, cause you know, I spend so much time on the internet. I can hear, oh, she was just in the right place at the right time. Sit down, Ken. You can see her bouncing and calculating what the play is going to be. Then she takes the guy out. Hop on over to the Bob and Sheri Facebook, and I'll post the video right now, and you can watch it.
I wonder how many actresses who became, you know, famous were ball girls for the Dodgers. I've never heard of one before. Have you?
Nope. But I bet.
Or a famous model or something like that.
Nope. Never heard of. I guess I thought ball girls and ball boys were children, not, you know, 24-year-old movie-star-looking people. Mm-hmm. Coming up on today's show, this is, speaking of sports, how perfect is this? Super psyched because Frank Caliendo is going to pop by the show a little bit later on today. And then there's more than one flavor of narcissist. There are actually two completely opposite types of narcissist, and they're both deadly. And we're going to teach you how to spot one in the wild and take it down, like that Dodgers ball girl did with that field invader. It's Bob and Sheri.
Get the moron of the day by texting moron to 888-BOB-SHERI.
You know, now that the Olympics are over, I have to say I became like slightly obsessed with one aspect of the Olympic Games. And the more I thought about it after I watched the closing ceremonies the other night, the more I realized of all the little packages I saw in the Olympics about, you know, the Olympic Village or the city of Tokyo or various athletes and their training regimens, I never caught the little video snippet that explained the bouquets that all the medal winners got. Did any of you?
No.
Because it's fascinating. Because I couldn't stand it anymore. And I said to myself, what if there was a way to get a question answered? Like what if you had a device in your hand that you could ask a question and it would tell you? And then I remembered that I have a phone. So the little bouquets that are carried by every Olympic and Paralympic gold or any medal winner have a really cool backstory. So there, it looks like there's like a goofy little cat and a bunch of flowers, if you've ever looked at it, right? So the mascot for the Olympic is this little creature that represents the traditions of Japan and its future, and another little mascot that represents strength and overcoming barriers. And they're like a cross between anime cats and robots. And those are part of the bouquet, which all by itself was kind of trippy. And I just couldn't figure out, like, what is with those goofy little flowers? And then I learned the meaning of it, and you could just about cry. So there are five types of flowers in those bouquets. And the flowers are grown in parts of Japan that are very symbolic. So two of the flowers, the Eustomus, I think they're pronounced, and the Solomon seals were grown in Fukushima, which was impacted by the earthquake and nuclear disaster in 2011. That's where those flowers come from.
Right.
The sunflowers in the bouquet come from Miyagi, and they represent the memories of the people that were affected by that same earthquake and nuclear disaster when the tsunami hit. And then there are gentians, those are the purpley blue flowers, and they come from a different prefecture, which is the most popular flower in Japan. And the color of that flower is part of the Tokyo Olympic Games kind of logo or emblem. And then there are these aspidistra flowers, which are grown in Tokyo, and they symbolize the host city. And then holding all those flowers together are these two little mascots, the Olympic and Paralympic mascots, representing traditions and future and struggle and overcoming. And every medal winner got one of these in a way of remembering the people that suffered and lost their lives in those big disasters, but mm-hmm. also to celebrate the strength of the people because they recovered from those. So it wasn't just like a silly little bouquet of flowers with a goofy cat. It was this really powerful
thing. There was meaning.
Thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Isn't that cool to know?
That's very cool. Yeah. That is.
Now, please ask me why I waited the entire Olympics, fixated on it and puzzling over it. Why I waited till the Olympics were over to ask that question. I don't know.
Because there's so many things to know these days.
Because oh, my God, yes.
We're inundated with information, you know? And so do you have time to track down everything? It's like when we've talked about, have you seen this on Netflix? No, but, you know, there are 80,000 things on Netflix. I just don't have time for it all. That's what that's all about.
My son-in-law, it always cracks me up when I say something like my son-in-law, because I can't believe I have a son-in-law. Because if one of my daughters had a husband, that would be problematic for me. They're way too young. But yeah. Thanks to my bonus children. So I'm driving to the hospital with my son-in-law to visit our little baby who's in NICU. And we're talking about the Olympics. And he goes, isn't it funny how, like, every 4 years you find yourself obsessed with table tennis? And then as soon as the Olympics yeah. are over, you're like, I'm not watching yeah. table tennis.
I know.
During the Olympic Games, we're all, like, experts on free diving and gymnastic floor routines and track and field. And
I'm always
watching that stuff?
Right? I know, and I'm always saying the same thing. Oh, surfing is part of the Olympics. Skateboarding is part of the Olympics. Oh, I didn't realize that, you know? And you can read it, and it's coming before the Olympics, but it's not until you actually sit down and watch it that you go, oh, that used to be just like a kid's sport. That used to be a sport nobody took seriously, and now it's in the Olympics.
But it's funny because as much as you enjoy watching it in the Olympics, you know that there's no world in which right. you'll be hunting through the 15 different ESPNs in hopes of right. finding some table tennis or curling to
right.
watch.
It's or even surfing.
It's an Olympic yeah. thing. Yeah. We got morons in the news straight ahead. And after you hear today's Moron of the Day, you'll think twice about reaching for that glass of water in the middle of the night. It's straight ahead. It's Bob and Sheri.
We've got them.
Dim-witted individuals.
Simple people.
With Bob and Sheri.
You're a moron.
It's Morons in the News. Da, da,
da. Have you seen the video of the iguana in the Florida dude's toilet? Oh, a trip to the bathroom took a terrifying turn for a Florida man after he found a spiny-tailed iguana in his toilet. His name is Kurt Hilberth, and he told CBS affiliate WFOR, which is probably Channel 10, WFOR, that he went to the bathroom to brush his teeth, and he spotted a disturbing sight out of the corner of his eye. Quote, it was so big that it was not submerged completely in the water, and it's got a tail that whips back and forth. The Hollywood, Florida resident said he initially decided to take matters into his own hands by dressing in protective gear and attempting to pull the iguana from the toilet by himself. However, every time Hilberth went to do it, the reptile kept swimming back down into the drain. It was total chaos. He said, unfortunately, I was left with a handful of tail, and he just could not get it. So after 3 days, he decided to call for outside help. Mary, don't use the toilet in our room, okay? I didn't get the iguana yet. I'm gonna get it tomorrow, don't worry. Are you kidding me? Would you wait 3 days to call for help?
I would have tried to lure it out with food.
I would have just called a dude like Trapper Harold Rondon. He's finally was the guy they called. And Rondon said, I went, grabbed him, He turned around and got caught with everything. I don't know what that means. And I finally was able to get a hand around him. According to the Miami Zoo, that particular breed of iguana is particularly dangerous to have inside a home. Quote from the zoo, the spiny-tailed iguana does tend to be more aggressive. It's quicker to bite and should not be handled. All iguanas carry a variety of bacteria. And then, listen to this quote. This is from the owner, the guy that tried to get him for 3 days. Your bear behind is over the toilet, and there's something in there. Something with teeth. Something that can bite you down there. This is a really shivering kind of thought. You're at a very vulnerable point. Yes, Hildreth. That's why you call somebody to come and get the toilet. Not 3 days later. Good heavens, he's crazy.
It was living in the sewer system and climbed up somehow
it got
into the toilet.
A vent. They think it got into a vent on the roof of the building and somehow made itself, pushed itself through the sewer. Yeah, through the pipes. Good Lord.
You know, between pythons and iguanas,
Ford, it can be a dangerous place. You're right.
Wow. Let's go now to the UK, where a man reached for a glass of water on his bedside table in the middle of the night and instead picked up a lit candle and drank the melted wax.
No.
He said, wow. I woke up groggy and thirsty in the middle of the night, reached out to my nightstand to feel for my water. Grabbed the first brown thing I found. It just so happened to be a candle. I didn't realize what I'd done until I had a mouthful of warm, sweet, rosemary, vanilla candle wax.
Oh, my word. Is he okay?
Yeah, he's okay, he said. I spit it out, but it coated my teeth and the roof of my mouth. Scraping all of that off was annoying. I don't know what was going through my mind. I just wish I could have seen myself drinking the candle because I still don't understand it. I don't know how you drink melted candle wax and not burn yourself?
I don't know either. But, you know, the upside for him is his breath now smells like Nantucket morning. You know? It's lovely.
One comment on it was, damn, son, you waterproofed your mouth. You'll be able to drink so much faster without all that drag. Okay, so choice. You can drink the melted candle wax, or you can sit on the toilet with a spiny-tailed iguana. Is it even a question?
Wow. Here comes the wax.
I think the wax. Yeah.
Text the word moron right now to 888-262-7437. We'll send today's Moron of the Day straight to your phone. Plus, you'll be registered to win a bottle of People Make Me Sick, the official hand sanitizer of the Bob and Sheri Show. We got Frank Caliendo coming up, plus comedian Nikki Carr, and there are two different kinds of narcissists. How to spot them in the wild and protect yourself. It's Bob and Sheri.
Get Lamar's reviews sent to your phone and qualify for a Fandango gift card. Text MOVIE to 888-BOB-SHERI.
I just love it when I'm right. I do. And I want to talk about this because I was right, and it doesn't happen all that often. And so I want to point it out. I made a prediction, and please don't say, oh, you're just spreading the idea, because believe me, people have figured this out, and they figured it out probably before I did. Do you remember when we were talking about the cards that were going around? Let me just read this article. San Luis Obispo, California, as the Delta variant of the coronavirus sweeps across the United States, a growing number of colleges and universities are requiring proof of COVID vaccination for students to attend in-person classes. So what other students wanted and what college professors wanted and what the college management wanted was that for you to come in and, you know, have in-person classes, you have to have a card that says, I have been vaccinated with the two shots. Well, already, I predicted several weeks ago, and I think we just talked about it a few days ago, that there would be an industry that would provide you online with fake vaccination cards. And guess what? They are springing up all over the place. $25 is the cheapest price that people have been able to find. And some of them, I guess they're a little bit better, are $200. $200. It's a complete ripoff. They're using the CDC logo. I'm looking at the card that is fake, and I'm looking at the one that I have in my wallet, and they look exactly alike. I knew this was going to happen. And here's, if you don't have kids and your kids or your kids don't have any friends, right? You may say, oh, I don't think that's going to be doable. Every kid that I have known in the last 10 years has had a fake ID when they went off to college to go to the local bars. Everyone, their friends, they've all got, because I've said, I don't want to use names. Everybody knows who's been living in my house, but I would say, how did you go to that bar? Oh, you're kidding. All of your friends have them too. These kids know how to get these things. They know how to get them when they're teenagers, and they're going to know how to get them with a vaccination card. It just seems to me, wouldn't it be easier just to get vaccinated?
Well,
it doesn't cost you anything.
Yes, but there are people who feel so strongly about that vaccine that they're not going to get it no matter what. And that's like shouting into the wind. Okay.
Yeah, I understand. I understand. So, I think though, if you're doing that and you're putting other students in harm's way or professors in harm's way, and the college finds out that that's a fake ID, I think maybe you should be kicked out for a semester.
If your school mandates vaccination, like Karamea's school, you have to be vaccinated or you're not allowed to attend. So if the school mandates vaccination and you fake it, then that would be grounds to expel you, right? That just makes sense because then you've committed fraud. But if your school is vaccine optional and you have a fake ID, I don't think that's going to be anything more than a slap on the wrist. And I'm not saying that that's correct. I just think that's how it's going to be.
I think it's more than a slap on the wrist if you're caught in a bar with a fake ID.
Yes,
I mean,
but that's a different.
I never
that's
had
a different
one
thing, Bob.
I
it's against.
Drink.
It's against the law to consume alcohol if you're under the age of 21, but it's not against the law to be unvaccinated. So yes, if you're caught in a bar with a fake ID, that's a different penalty than being caught in a dorm with a fake vaccination ID.
Yes, but a college
laws.
A college can have standards for things. They can say our standard is you must be vaccinated.
I think only private schools can do that, though, because if you're in a public, because I have one daughter in a private school and one daughter in a public school. The private school gets to make whatever rules it wants. And if she doesn't want to follow them, she can go elsewhere. The public school, it does not have that same amount of control. So I really do think it depends on what school you're in, what your penalties might be, right?
Yeah, I knew this was going to happen. It's going to be a mess.
The college I went to had no standards. Colleges have standards. No, my dad. Northern Virginia Community College had no standards whatsoever.
Did you have a fake ID when you were a young person?
No. I didn't. I never needed
a
fake
Sheri?
ID.
I didn't, but you know why? Because I couldn't get one. I didn't have the internet. I'd have had a fake ID if I could have gotten a fake ID. I'm not going to sit here and pretend that I was too good for that because I was too stupid to have a fake ID.
I was too fearful of doing something like that because it would, what do you have to do to get it? You have to do something illegal. You have to, I wouldn't do it. Because I was tall at a young age, I never had to worry about it. Because if somebody would turn me down, somebody else would let me.
Yeah, yeah. I didn't drink until I was 25. I mean, I've made up for it since then, but I just didn't need one. How about you, Doc? You're what, 14 years old now? Do you have a fake ID?
No, I've never had a fake ID before.
You never have? No. Yeah. Okay, well, we're 0-4. I guess that somewhat speaks well of us.
Though, because Doc was a good person. You didn't drink. Max didn't get carded, and I was stupid. Don't get nuts and say that it speaks well of us, because
I wouldn't say that. Yeah, I'm with you, Sheri.
Now, what does speak well of us is that Frank Caliendo is next, but let's just kind of like sweep this whole fake ID thing under the rug, because it does not reflect well on us at all. It's Bob and Sheri.
Birthdays, holidays, promotions, there's a lot in this world worth celebrating. But nothing is worth celebrating more than knowledge that pays off. Like understanding how compound interest works, knowing how to check your investment professional's background, or figuring out your risk tolerance.
Or finally understanding those terms your friends throw around like ETF, ESG, and ICO. Learn about these investment products and more at investor.gov, your unbiased resource for valuable investment information, tools, and tips. Before you invest, investor.gov.
Do you own or rent your home? Sure you do, and I bet it can be hard work at times. You know what's easy? Bundling policies with GEICO. GEICO makes it easy to bundle your homeowner's or renter's insurance along with your auto policy.
It's a good thing, too, because you already have so much to do around your home. Go to GEICO.com, get a quote, and see how much you could save. It's GEICO easy. Visit GEICO.com today. That's GEICO.com.
It's the Bob and Sheri Store's sizzling summer sidewalk sale. Everything in stock is on sale, 10% off.
10% off!
Including Sheri Lynch's cookbook, Cooking with Cats. And swag you can use, like Bob and Sheri 24-ounce latte mugs, travel mugs, H2Go water bottles. And our very hot line of mother of all mothers merch, including tote bags, candles, wear around tee and sleep shirts.
10% off.
It's the sizzling summer sidewalk sale. Everything is 10% off. Just hit shop at bobandsheri.com and use the discount code podcast at checkout. Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
Frank Caliendo is one of our very favorite performers. He's just loved by people all over the world, literally, and he is back on the road. On Monday, he's going to be in Nashville. He's going to be in Minneapolis at the Acme Comedy Club. That's on Tuesday. And on Sunday, he is in Charlotte, and he is with us right now. He'd be in Charlotte at the Comedy Zone. Frank, how are you?
You know, I'm doing magically, Bob. I don't know what that means. I'm not sure. What am I going to do, some table magic on the radio? Listen, then I got some ventriloquism table magic that I'm going to be making work.
Sheri, I think Frank has been in the house too long.
I have to say, Frank, when Bob asked you how you are and you went, that's how everybody feels right now.
Well, I'll tell you the other part of it is a couple days ago was my anniversary. So
happy anniversary.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Yes. 18 years of bliss, capital B. It's funny because recently my wife's even gotten a little bit of a job. I said, my wife's name is Michelle. I'm like, you're bored, especially with the, not just the pandemic, but I'm like, our house has become basically, our living room is an Amazon fulfillment center. I call it the Amazon self-fulfillment center. I mean, it's unbelievable. The kids are trying to unionize. There's people tinkling in bottles. It's really weird trying to make all the deliveries. So I'm not exactly sure when that happened or what's going on, but she was, I do it too. Like, when I'm not doing anything, I'll just go surf the web and I'll start buying things. I'm like, how about you get a job just to have something that you care about? Because the kids are getting older. So she started working for my brother-in-law, and it's this thing called Phone Ninjas. They listen to phone calls, which is interesting in itself. I'll have to tell you guys that another time we really get into it. But they listen to quality assurance phone calls.
Right. Wait, Frank, stop. This is the when you get that message, this call may be recorded for quality assurance purposes. That's actually really happening, and your wife is listening to them?
Oh yeah, and the other day there was one where she'll pull. You got to hear this. Pull, and there was a car dealership where somebody a police officer called because the car dealership had sold a car that they thought that had been impounded or something that had been stolen. Yeah. And like this whole thing. I'm like, I don't know if that's real though, because I can't believe that a VIN number would get that. I'm like, that might be a scam trying to scam or a private investigator or something. Like, you don't know, but it's people will answer the phone. And it's so funny how people answer the phone, even at the, established businesses. There'll be people that answer the phone like, hello, like they don't say where they're at what right. the name of the company is and stuff like that. So they call, they listen to these things, and then they, you know, they give coaching on how to make calls. There are certain industries where if you do, you know, there's no real floor to get in. So you can, right. you don't even have to have a high school diploma. You get in. So it's people that are just, and there's huge turnover because it's not a big paying job, but people want to try and work their way through. So you'll have people who don't have any phone skills whatsoever, and right. they're losing money. These companies are losing a ton of money. So they, you know, they listen to the calls and stuff like that. But it's, so my wife says, you know, she's made, she's just starting out, so she's made about $2,000, and she spent $6,500 of it. trying to understand how that, like, she spent that same $2,000 multiple. So she's like, "Well, I'm working now." I'm like, "Yeah, but yeah, but that's not. It doesn't add up." she does that with credit cards too. She'll do that with a credit card. She'll be like, "I spent $500." No. That's the most you spent in one place. You also spent $200 over here, $50. You don't just pick the highest one, and that's the one that get, you know, that you have to pay. You have to pay it right. all off.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
She's just crushing me. It's some of those things she's just getting me with. I'm just like, oh my goodness.
There are so many people nodding their heads right now.
I do the same kind of math as your wife, so I can't judge her.
Yeah, so, I'm not asking you to judge. I'm just asking you to understand where I'm coming from. That's all I want.
Right. So let me ask you. You're back on the road. You can go to frankonstage.com to see where Frank is appearing and all. Let me just ask you, as a performer, is Biden good or bad for you?
I think it's good. People haven't. There isn't really an established Biden out there yet, but I've been doing it, and it's getting better and better.
Can we pause for a second? Yeah. Can we pause for a second? We'll take a quick break, and then we'll come back with more Frank Caliendo.
That's what I was giving. I was giving you guys a teaser.
I heard the music.
You guys screwed up your own teaser.
We screwed up our own show. I know.
But there's a book about how to be better at this on Amazon. Your wife and I are about to order it. Sit tight. More with Frank Caliendo straight ahead. FrankOnStage.com. It's Bob and Sheri.
Swag you can use. Just hit shop at bobandsheri.com.
And we are back with our guest, Frank Caliendo. He's actually out on the road, and we were just talking in the break. He's done a handful of dates, really, since all of this started, and it's so good to be back out performing. FrankOnStage.com for all of the places he's going to be. He's going to be in Denver, Minneapolis, Columbus, Charlotte. He's all over the place. And so, Frank, when we stopped, you were saying that you're working up your Biden.
Yeah, well, I mean, last time I was really on stage and doing full shows, Donald Trump was still president, and I mean, he just talks all the time, right? It didn't even matter what he said, and I've broken it down to three words: probably and quite frankly. And it's just probably, quite frankly. Now with Joe Biden, he's nasally, so it makes it a little more difficult. Any nasal voice seems to be tougher for anybody. I don't know why that is. Maybe if you can pinch your nose or something, that could do. But you can't really do that while you're on stage, although it might be funny. With Biden, I've noticed a few things. Like when he wants to accentuate a point, he will repeat it in the whisper at the end of the sentence, right? He'll be like, he's talking about the shots or the vaccine or something. He'll be like, "It's not politics. It's science. And then he goes, "It's not the heat. It's the humidity. It's not delivery. It's DiGiorno. You know the deal. Come on." And when he doesn't know,
so
I mean, he
right
gets, well, Trump was like the crazy uncle that you need a chaperone with, even though he's in your own family. And Biden's like Grandpa Joe, right? He gets lost even at in the middle of a sentence. When Trump would do that, he would just make up things, probably, quite frankly, because of me. Joe Biden will go to, he'll get lost and be like, "And then, you know, come on, you know the deal." Like, he'll be in the middle of, he wouldn't be talking about it, but astrophysics, he'd be like, "Come on, you know the deal." No, we don't. That's why you're talking about it. And he struggles with numbers. The numbers are so tough. He'll be like, when I was, and everything goes back to Scranton, Pennsylvania, right? It's like when I was man, back in Scranton, Pennsylvania, 30, 40, 500 years ago. 500 years ago? What do you mean? You know the deal. Come on. What is the thing? The guy.
Oh, my God. You've got him.
Yeah. And, so he's, I think there's a lot to do with him. It's just, all my impressions, no matter, especially politics, I stay out of the politics and make them the character. Where are they? What makes, you know, anybody you dislike? I was told this years and years ago. I don't remember who it was by, probably because I'm a narcissist, but it was one of those things where they're like, you can find something you really love about somebody, and that's how you make the character, or you can find something you really hate. And I chose, I like the things. I find what I like. I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't believe this person does that. When you watch Alec Baldwin, he would do Trump. You could tell that was coming from, like, dislike, tremendous hate dislike. When I do Trump, it's just silly. Like, I can't believe he's doing quite, probably. And a lot of people are saying, who's saying? A lot of people. Who? A tremendous amount of people. Like, how do you do that and go with it? So I find that thing that I like about people and I find interesting. So that to me is what makes these impressions work, and you find the character of them and then go with that. So it's like that
great.
With all of them. Yeah, I have a lot of fun with it. So
has it been just awful to be in the house, not on the road? I mean, coming off of the road for a performer and you're just going nowhere. It must be bizarre. You must have an engine that's always running, ready to go.
I think you've seriously miscalculated who I am. No, listen, I'm an odd person in this industry. I mean, I never wanted to get into stand-up. I was always kind of embarrassed as a kid. I was quiet. I've actually enjoyed a lot of it, other than, you know, not making. I get embarrassed when people, laugh and clap. It's really weird to do what I do. Johnny Carson used to say that thing where it's like, what? When you go out on stage every night, they clap for you. You know, I'm weirded out, but that's why my act is so fast. I would cut out a lot of the laughs and go to the next thing because I was like, don't you realize I have a lot to say here about these people? So. No, I think it's been different. I had more family dinners than I've ever had before, which is great. So, you know, you look for the positives and things.
Yeah, that's the way to look at it. Well, folks, you got to catch him. He's back on the road. Go to frankonstage.com, frankonstage.com. He's coming to Nashville. He's coming to Minneapolis and in Charlotte on Sunday. Frank, it's a delight to hear you. And it's a delight to know that you've found another president to poke a little fun at.
They're always there.
They're always there. You take care. We'll be seeing
you
soon.
Thank you, guys.
Yep.
Thank you.
Bye.
It's Bob and Sheri.
The Odd Podcast. Stuff we wouldn't, couldn't, or shouldn't say on the show. Sent directly to your phone by texting ODDCAST to 888-BOB-SHERI.
It is time for your Wednesday edition of Everyone Needs a Laugh. Today, we are featuring comedian Nikki Carr.
I can't follow ridiculous rules. Before I worked for the Javis Center, I had another job that I wasted time on. I love this job. I work for this big corporation. You might have heard of them. They're called Church's Fried Chicken. Yeah. Chicken was delicious. The rules to work in there, impossible to follow. They were ridiculous. When the chicken stays under the light too long, don't sell it. But don't eat it either. Why not? Like, you're not selling it? Why can't I have it? They said every piece gets counted at the end of the night, and then they throw it away. You do what? You should have put that in the application. I would not have taken this job. Because I like the chicken when it's been under the light extra long. It made it even more crispy and good. You guys don't know that because they throw it away. I was at the company meeting trying to make changes and great suggestions. Like, excuse me. Hi. Yeah, over here. Why can't we eat the chicken and count the bones? Wouldn't that be the same amount of chicken? So yeah, they just like, you know, sit down, please. Okay, well, thank you. Every time I went to the bathroom, I couldn't save them all, but four or five of you, come with me. Yes, indeed. I love this. No one could have ever told me that I would be this old and feel this good, really. 57, like, I feel like more than half of my life is over, you know? And I only say that because I know that I don't want to live to be 100. No, thank you. Because I don't like people's response when you pass away and you're 100. You know, Nikki died. Well, it's about time, don't you think? She lived a whole century. What more do you want? I don't mind getting older, and I hang out with a lot of older people older than me. As soon as I got 50, they started putting all these rules on me and everything. You know what you got to do now, right? I'm like, what? You have to get a bucket list. I am extremely intelligent. I never heard of this. I didn't know what it was. But I wanted to be politically correct, so I did start one. I don't even have maybe four entries I have on there. That's it. Entry number one, buy yourself a bucket. You don't have a bucket. Entry number two, don't kick that bucket. Number three, I have four children, four. And I've never had a baby shower. I know! Never had a baby shower, so I'm gonna have one now. And you are all invited to bring things that my grown kids need. Thank you. And this is the big one, don't judge me. But while I'm alive and well and feeling this good, I would like to throw myself a funeral. Yeah, I want to see who comes. And whoever doesn't show up, guess what? They better not die. I'm not coming to yours either. But I want to do this. Like, it's your last party. And I just don't like the things that go on at funerals, you know? So I want to do it now and make sure they do it right. Like, don't be saying I'm going home to rest. I hate when they say that at funerals and then they dress you like you're going to a party. So now I'm going to be there sleeping, dressed like I'm going to a party, and people are going to walk by and go, oh, she looks just like herself. Now! Put me in my pajamas. Turn me on my side, put a pillow under my arm and head. Now you can say she looks just like herself. Now you can say
that is so true.
That is comedian Nikki Carr. You can find her on our website, BOBANDSHERI.com. Click stop, heard more stuff from the show, and look for Everyone Needs a Laugh. And we feature all of the comedy sets right there. It's Bob and Sheri.
Leave us a talkback. Talkback with the free Bob and Sheri app.
How long have Sheri Lynch and I been working together? So far that today our minds actually melded. They actually melded together. We just featured comedian Nikki Carr, who did this fantastic stand-up. And she was talking about when she worked at Church's Fried Chicken. And then Sheri and I, right after it, said, okay, for the next thing, the next break that we get, I've got the perfect thing. And I said, no, I've got the perfect thing. She said, I've got it. We both had the exact same thing.
Mine meld.
That we wanted to do. So let's start off by playing Nikki Carr, and then we'll jump.
I love this job. I work for this big corporation. You might have heard of them. They're called Church's Fried Chicken. Yeah. Chicken was delicious. The rules to work in there, impossible to follow. They were ridiculous. When the chicken stays under the light too long, don't sell it. But don't eat it either. Why not? Like, you're not selling it? Why can't I have it? They said every piece gets counted at the end of the night, and then they throw it away.
So, That's that story. And that is disgusting that that food is being wasted. So there is a woman whose name is Anna Sachs. She lives in Manhattan, and she is disgusted with how we just throw away so much stuff that it's ridiculous. And so she has a TikTok thing she does and a Facebook thing she does. She goes with a push cart through Manhattan, and she is a beautiful woman, long, flowing red hair. And she goes through the contents of stores that have thrown out stuff. Sheri?
And it is shocking. Food, personal grooming products, feminine hygiene, over-the-counter medication. And, you know, like sometimes they companies throw stuff away because it's past its sell-by date, but it's still good, right? It's still perfectly edible. And sometimes, like what Nikki Carr was describing, like there are actually hungry people in the world and on the street and everywhere, and they're just – they don't want to give the product away, and they don't sell it, so they throw it away, and it's really gross. And she goes through the garbage every single day. If you want to follow her on TikTok, her TikTok is The Trash Walker, all one word, all lowercase. She goes through, like, she went through the garbage at a CVS, protein bars, toothpaste, hairbrushes, tampons, and instead of just throwing it away where somebody could dumpster dive and find it and use it or donate it, whoever at that particular drugstore, whoever did it, squeezed the toothpaste all over everything so that it was like sticky and gross and ruined so that it couldn't be reused.
It's not just food. It's also, she went to Party City right after like Halloween. And they threw out all of these tablecloths, and they threw out all of these costumes, and they threw out all of the things. Some of them were not even Halloween related. They were just, you know, things that were sold around that time of the year. Threw it all out. It goes into the dump, and it stays there for 1,000 years. It's awful.
And there are, like, in one of her posts, there are all these things that could have been donated. Like, for example, the Party City stuff Bob's talking about. Some of that could have been donated to like a children's hospital. And in fact, when she fished it out of the garbage, somebody came forward who followed her on TikTok and said, I work with sick kids. Can I have some of that? It's furniture too, like a love seat or an office chair or whatever didn't sell. And they'll take an X-Acto knife and they'll slash the bejeebers out of it so that it's ruined and then throw it in the garbage. And so if you think about it, not every place does this. Like in the city where I live and probably all over the country, the Panera Bread stores, at the end of the day, they donate their unsold baked goods to shelters to be distributed to people that need food. A lot of companies are trying to do better, but it's this combination of one, you're filling the landfills with perfectly good usable products and edible food. And that's bad. Like Bob said, you know, that plastic Halloween costume is going to take 1,000 years to degrade. But also in a world where people are hungry and really struggling,
Starbucks is a
right
terrific company. And she found the Starbucks trash that they throw away is a king's feast of unsold food every single night. Within a week of her stories being published, Starbucks announced new goals. And I hope they actually follow through with landfill waste. I know some of you are saying the reason they do this is because if somebody gets sick on that piece of church's fried chicken because for whatever reason it was contaminated, then there's going to be a lawsuit. We have to figure out how not to litigate everything in this country. If you take their food, you sign an agreement that if something goes wrong, it ain't your fault. It's not the fault of the restaurant.
One of the things that she said was like, look, if the retailer or the restaurant does not want to donate this stuff to the public, okay, all right. What about your own workforce? Because you have at a lot of places very low wage workers that don't get free food or whatever. And you could, rather than throwing away a box of muffins, you could say, hey, at the end of the night, whatever isn't sold, divide it up. Go ahead and
you
take
know those
it.
Those sandwiches that they make and they put them in the microwave. So I mean it's not like you're eating in a five-star restaurant, but the sandwiches they make at Starbucks are really good. They're very tasty, and they could the employees could take them home, heat them up, and it'd be fine. Somebody in their family would be fed. I agree with you, Sheri.
So if you want to follow this and support this and maybe see what's going on in your own town, it is at the Trash Walker on TikTok. And you can probably Google her. It and find her on other platforms. It's a really interesting idea. And for those of us that have worked in retail and restaurants, you know that everything she's saying is true because you've probably been asked as part of your job to do it.
Wait a minute. I'm getting another simpatico moment where our minds are melting together. They're melding together. I'm seeing a vodka cocktail at the end of the day. I'm just seeing it right there.
Oh my God, get out of my brain.
Huh? Is that not amazing?
That's so good.
It's Bob and Sheri.
I live in a world of sound. I have earbuds in all the time. Earbuds for work, earbuds when I'm out walking with the dog, earbuds when I'm cleaning the house. And since I've discovered Raycon wireless earbuds, I'm really a happy camper. And here's why. A couple of reasons. First, Raycons are super comfortable. They have the perfect snug in-ear fit. They don't stick out at all. You honestly forget you're wearing them. Never thought I'd be able to say that about in-ear earbuds. And they have incredible sound. And they cost about half the price of other premium audio brands. And wait for this, a 32-hour battery life. So you pop your Raycons in and you get on with your day. And you're not constantly worried about having to recharge and stop what you're doing. And with Raycons, whether you're listening to music or a podcast with Raycon or the radio with Raycons, you've just got crisp, beautiful, clear sound. And again, at about half the price of other premium audio brands. And if you've never tried wireless earbuds and you're like, I don't know if I'm going to love that, the Raycons come with a 45-day happiness guarantee, so you really can't lose. You give them a try, you'll see what I mean. You're going to love the battery life. You're going to love the sound quality. You're going to love the comfortable fit. You're going to love the price. You can create your very own soundtrack to the day with Raycon. Right now, Bob and Sheri listeners can take 15% off their Raycon order at buyraycon.com/Sheri. That's buyraycon.com/Sheri. You'll save 15% on your whole order. So when the world gets crazy, you pop in your Raycons and you tune it out to your own private soundtrack. 15% off. buyraycon.com/Sheri.
Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
It is talk back time. If you have our app, it's free in Google Play in the App Store. You just download it, and there's a little microphone in the bottom right corner of the screen. You can tap it and talk. There are other ways to reach the show, too, but by God, don't try to call us on the phone because we can't figure out when it rings where it's ringing to. It's certainly not ringing here. Let's hit it, Max.
Hi, Bob and Sheri. My name's Christy, and I listen to you guys every day in Steamboat Springs, Colorado, in my trash truck. And
oh, wow.
I just want to say how much I love you guys, and I love the Oddcast as well. I used to try to make sure that I would catch the Oddcast live, but I realized if I save the Oddcast for Saturday morning, that completes my week. Anyway, a couple of things I've learned from you guys. Sheri, you taught me, girl, you just do you and live your best life. And Bob, from you, I've learned it just doesn't matter. So thanks for being a daily part of my life. And I was just listening to the Oddcast, and Sheri, I too look like poo. Anyway, you guys have a great day.
And let
she
me
means
just
the
say
character.
Yeah, I was going to say, for people that weren't with us that day, it's Winnie the Pooh.
Winnie the Pooh,
although,
yeah, exactly.
Although let me also say that there are other days where it's the other Pooh. It just kind of depends on the day.
What a nice person. I'm so glad that she's one of our listeners there in beautiful Steamboat Springs. That was the first place I ever skied in Colorado. And Billy Kidd was the pro there years and years ago, who was an Olympic athlete. If you're a skier and you're thinking of Colorado, go to Steamboat Springs. It's such a great cowboy town. Isn't that sweet? It's interesting that what she takes away from me is it just doesn't matter. Which is a quote that we've pulled from Bill Murray, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Didn't Bill Murray said, don't worry about so many things because it really doesn't matter. And we started incorporating that into the show. So,
and yet the problem that we have is, for us, it does matter. And that's why we're eaten alive. We are not good. We say, like, we should be like Bill Murray and be very zen and say it doesn't matter. But the truth is just the opposite for us. It does matter. It matters too much. And that's why we're eaten alive.
I try to, you're incorporating it into business. I try to incorporate it into worries that I have with everyday things.
No. I wasn't referring to the business of the show. I was referring to the two of us as human beings, not the show. You can tell me all day long how good you are and it doesn't matter. And it would be a giant lie because it does. Everything matters so, so, so much. We are not good at that whole Zen thing. And now I will sit here quietly while you tell me how good you are at being Zen and letting it go.
I'm not saying that I'm great at it. I'm saying that I am trying to incorporate that into my everyday living. Let me give you an example. Mary and I were headed to, I forget what it was. I think I had a dentist appointment and she wanted to do something in that area. And I said, okay, are you ready to go? And she wasn't, you know, she was not ready to go. And so we were going to be late for the dental appointment, which I can't stand to be late for, especially doctor type appointments. And I just kept saying to myself, it's fine. It's going to be fine. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And she's, why are you so uptight? You know, I'm uptight because we're, you know, going to be late. Well, then blame me. I'm not getting into a fight with you over this. It doesn't matter. And so actually did feel, because it's a doctor, that it did matter. But you know what? I showed up and they said, he's a little behind right now and he'll be with you in about 5 minutes because it just didn't matter.
And then you can't even make eye contact with your wife because you know that if you look over at her, she's going to be like, see, it's fine. You got all worked up for nothing.
Well, actually, she didn't know. She dropped me off and I went in.
And you never, of course, told. Yeah,
I might have. I might have told her. I can't remember right now. I mean, that would be the right thing to do, right?
I wish. I think every single day, try to be more Zen. Try to be more Zen. Try to be more Zen. But everything matters to me. Like every tiny detail matters to me so much about every little thing, and it is. It's exhausting.
It is exhausting.
That's where stress and like exhaustion comes from, is being so caught up in all of the things that matter. And that's why Bill Murray is having such a fun time.
Yeah.
So many of us are not having a fun time.
Well, one of the reasons Bill and I probably differ in this area is he's got about $100 million. And when you have about $100 million, does anything really matter?
But you know what? He was like this when he didn't have $100 million.
Yeah, maybe so. Maybe so.
No, definitely so. He's always been like this. We are who we are. And it's when you, and I think another thing that causes misery is when you deny your essential nature and fight it. That's a form of self-hatred. Like, we are who we are. Like, we should just lean into the fact that we care a lot. Like, we do. Yeah, we just care a lot. We can't help it. And the next time somebody in your family tells you to settle down, just say, you know what? I would love to settle down. There's nothing I'd like better than settling down. But I care so much about all of these outcomes. And then let them feel like crap because they don't care enough. You see how you can work that to your advantage?
It's interesting.
They're not going to feel that way. They're going to roll their eyes. When I say the words, it's because I care so much. I roll, Hugh.
That's a rationalization because caring way too much becomes like mental illness.
Yeah, that's true. Well, yeah, I have the t-shirt for that. I can tell you that. It's Bob and Sheri.
The Bob and Sheri website, the Oddcast, contest info, bobandsheri.com.
So last week I was at a podcast conference in Nashville. And it was interesting because the whole thing, it was half virtual, half in person because of COVID. And they were really good about social distancing and masks and all that. And they held it at there's a convention center at the Gaylord Opryland Resort.
And I've stayed there. I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah.
You and I stayed there a million years ago when we were in Nashville shooting some TV commercials and stuff for
That's
radio.
Right.
And I hadn't been back since then. And there was apparently like a terrible flood and did a ton of damage. And they've done all these renovations. The Gaylord Opryland is so enormous. I kid you not. Like I wear like a tracker, fitness tracker. Just getting from the front door to where the sessions were and back again was the equivalent of walking 2 miles. That is no, Doc will tell you, it is no exaggeration. We were clocking like 10, 11, 12, 13,000 steps, just walking into the door to go to a session and back again. And in the main hall, they did this really cool thing. They had a Jack Daniel's whiskey tasting bar set up. And they had the Humane Society of Nashville brought out a pen with puppies. And you could throughout the day go over to the pen. All you had to do, you had to sort of disinfect your hands and wait your turn. And then you could pick up and hold puppies and sit with puppies in your lap and kiss puppies and have puppies walking all over your face as much as you possibly wanted. So to your left was the Jack Daniel's tasting bar and to your right was the pen full of puppies. We posted a picture of the puppy pen. And of course, you know that I made a beeline for those puppies. I had puppies in my hair.
So
I had puppies in my crawling down my shirt. I loved it. And one of our listeners commented on it, Linda DeMoranville Souza, who said, "I love your show. I listen every morning. Tell Bob I said hi. LOL. I'd love to hear you say hi to me on the radio. Linda from Maine." So, hey, shouting you out, Linda Souza in Maine. I think that puppies should be in more places. I saw how happy people were to touch and look at and even just think about puppies.
You're
I think we need puppies in more spots. I think we need to identify really high stress zones in our everyday lives. And we need to have puppies come to those places because dogs are the best thing in the world. We don't even deserve to have them. They're so amazing. Can you imagine like if there were puppies at the DMV?
That'd be a perfect place. Yes.
Yeah. Puppies at, have you ever had to, this is what I'm about to describe, folks, is an entire nightmare. And anyone that's gotten married or divorced and changed their name has lived it. Folks, have you ever been to a Social Security office in the USA? They need puppies at the Social Security office and at the DMV. They need puppies at registration for schools. They need puppies at long, long, long lines at Walmart. Where else do we need a puppy?
Well, I'll tell you where it would have been good, even a dog, but a puppy would be fantastic, or multiple puppies. The old station that we refer to once in a while, it was such a toxic environment before we moved from it, that a dog coming through the halls of that place would have lifted spirits. I mean, there were people who were crying in their offices. If you brought, actually, somebody did bring in their dog. They had a Labradoodle. Remember that?
And
then
that
they were told, never to do it again. Yeah.
And do you know why that was? Because the management at the time could not bear to see joy on the employees' faces.
No, was that the reason? I didn't know that.
You think that's a joke? Yeah. That dog made people so happy. And management was like, excuse me, that's not what we're here to do. We will not have this joy.
Right.
We will not have this
that's
happiness.
Right. I think
and
that's
also,
a great
dogs,
idea.
Dogs can smell evil. So dogs, puppies don't want to go into that building. And speaking of our former management, straight ahead, there are two different kinds of narcissists. They're both diabolical. We're going to teach you how to spot them in the wild so that you can save yourself. It's straight ahead. It's Bob and Sheri.
You read it once.
I don't believe that.
And then you read it again.
I can't believe this.
It's Bob and Sheri's.
I don't believe this.
When we think about narcissists, we think about people that are like really cocky and domineering and extroverted, people that are super bold and assertive and bossy and confident. And that's only one kind of narcissist. That's the grandiose narcissist. There are actually two kinds. The grandiose narcissist is easier to spot because that person fits our idea of what a narcissist is. And anyone that's ever worked for or dated or been married to or had a parent or family member that's a grandiose narcissist can see them coming a mile away. They have the best ideas and they have the best connections and they have the best stories, and it's kind of exhausting, right? Everything they everything they do, try, sample, touch, think of, dream of, or suggest is always the best. But there's another kind of narcissist. And this narcissist is withdrawn, neurotic, insecure. They tend to be anxious, hypersensitive, with low self-esteem. They're prone to depression. But both of these narcissists have something in common, and that is they're super selfish, and they believe that they're entitled to privileges and special treatment. And the way they connect with other people is in this very antagonistic way. So it's easy to spot the first narcissist because they're like, yes, I'm the best. But the second narcissist, and the name for that is a vulnerable narcissist, is a little harder to identify because they tend to be a little more shy and more anxious in social situations. And while your grandiose narcissists are really assertive in going after their goals, vulnerable narcissists tend to be defensive. And here's the biggest difference between them, and this is the easiest way to remember it. Grandiose narcissists are all about maximizing their own success, but vulnerable narcissists are all about minimizing their own failure. Isn't
that's interesting.
Interesting.
Yeah, it is. So what they have in common, though, is they both believe that they should have special treatment one way or the other.
And they're very selfish people. Mm-hmm. Like, the one thing that all narcissists have in common, they're really, really selfish. It's themselves first and foremost. And if there are a few crumbs or scraps, there might be a little bit of room or grace or attention or anything for another human being. But all your narcissists are super selfish. So let's say that again, because this is going to be a game changer. I think there are people listening right now that are like gripping a tabletop or a steering wheel with both hands and going, oh my God, because you don't think of the anxious, shy, introverted person.
No, you think of the blowhard.
As narcissist. Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So
that's
the
right.
The blowhard is about maximizing success. And the
like a good example of the blowhard, unfortunately, the audience doesn't know who we're talking about, really. But we had a CEO of a company a couple of companies back, and there was a magazine. The company had a monthly magazine, and this jackass put himself on the cover of every other issue. Even if he wasn't doing anything, and his letter to the employees was from the corner office. I mean, it was just everything was about this jerk.
He was a grandiose. Yeah,
he was grandiose, right.
And it wasn't about the employees of the company achieving things and getting on the... It was him getting honorary degrees from different places and stuff.
From colleges nobody's ever heard of. Exactly.
So here's another thing they have in common. So it's always selfishness, right? That's like your first flag. Mm-hmm. Now, your grandiose narcissist is grabbing for success. Your vulnerable narcissist is doing everything they can to minimize their rate of failure. Mm-hmm. Grandiose narcissists feel that they, no matter what the situation is, that they've met their social goals and they're getting it done socially. They've got connections, friends, networks, they're admired, blah, blah, blah. Vulnerable narcissists always feel that they didn't get what they deserved. They didn't get the status they deserved, the success they deserved. They're victims. Yeah, it's that victim thing. Both types of narcissists crave admiration and respect. But your grandiose narcissists are all about the spotlight. Your vulnerable narcissists are on the sidelines feeling so much resentment because they didn't get what they felt was theirs.
You know how you can really spot a grandiose narcissist very easily? Especially if the person is, successful in business. When you walk into, especially in radio, when you walk into their office and the waiting area is filled with pictures of them with celebrities. Now, maybe they were with the celebrity for like 10 seconds, but boy, they got that photo. And they want you to see that they stood next to and maybe were friends with Justin Timberlake. This guy that I'm describing, people have told me, I never went to his office, but they said, you walk in and it's just every picture is about him. in the waiting area. And then all of these little plaques from the Rotary Club or wherever, because he showed up and did a speech and they gave him a, you know, they gave him an award for making a speech or something like that. You can tell, and I've been in some offices like that, you can tell them a mile away. It's all about, look at the people who love me.
You know, I think that both kinds of narcissists are exhausting and dangerous. But I think the quiet, the vulnerable narcissist is more dangerous because they're harder to spot.
Yeah, I agree
and
with you.
And you can be neck deep in their resentful, insecure, selfish victimhood before you even realize what hit you.
Yeah, that's right.
So, yeah, I think the second one is a little more diabolical. But I'll post this up on our Facebook so that you can check it out for yourselves. And now let go of whatever you're holding on to and stop screaming. Because now you know what to do. It's on our Facebook. It's Bob and Sheri.
Bob and Sheri, go.
And the rabbit hole that I went down was laid by the publication The Daily Mail. They have an online version, and the headline was, Ellen DeGeneres celebrates two decades of her show in farewell season. So the swan song is coming up on September 13th, and I'm reading this article, and it said that there was a teaser to the final show, that the final show would be a real big deal on September 13th. Max did a little digging, and he found that teaser. So let's give a listen to it. It's teasing the last show of Ellen DeGeneres.
2 decades of television. Hundreds of scares. 4,000 guests.
Come on.
Almost half a billion given away.
Oh, my God.
Countless lives changed.
We want to give each one of you a scholarship.
And one thankful host.
You've changed my life.
Ellen's farewell season starts September 13th.
So that's what is going to be on the show, along with a lot of highlights from A-list guests, obviously. I'm looking at Justin Timberlake, as a matter of fact, was on, danced with her. And that was very, very memorable. Julia Roberts broke down in tears. I didn't see that. It's going to be an interesting show. And reading about her, you know, I liked her show a lot, but and I felt badly that all of the toxicity was tied to her. But who knows whether she was to blame or not to blame. She lost 59% of her viewers after all of that toxic talk started in Los Angeles. Now, she lost, and this is interesting, she lost in Philly 32%. In San Francisco, she lost 50% of the audience. It went down 40% in New York City. But again, in Los Angeles, 59%. So
Let me just stop you here. The lowest percentage was Philadelphia because people there are like, hey, who isn't an asshole?
You know, that's probably true. They cut a girl a break, right? So I was talking to Max about this just before we went on, and I mentioned that that's a lot in Los Angeles, 59% of your viewers. And he said, because they know her better. You know, there have been
rumors. That is interesting. Yeah.
That's an interesting there's been rumors. It's a big city, but in some ways in show business, it's a small town because everybody talks, right? Everybody talks.
So somebody knows somebody who had heard something that she did.
Yeah.
And you know that sort of thing got around.
Yeah. She was averaging 1.5 million viewers by March, down 1.1 million. So, you know, the whole idea that she, you know, I've done it all. We've given away all of this, this and that. It's because of the loss of revenue.
It's
because of fewer people watching.
It's a staggering fall from grace.
It really is.
And shocking and unexpected. And interesting because one of the last things that they say in that little trailer thing is, and one very thankful host.
Right. Oh, they're softening it. That whole thing is to soften, you know, the blow.
We'll post that clip up on our Facebook and you can go watch it.
Watch what she did on Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee. It's on Netflix if you have Netflix.
Oh, yeah.
She wants to be liked. And that's really obvious from that. And I thought about that because I watched this, because that was all filmed before all of this stuff happened.
Oh,
and
it was.
It's very interesting how she's wired.
Yeah, yeah. So, quite a career. I mean, say what you want. I've always liked her, and just an amazing performer and quite a career. It's Bob and Sheri.
Now, let's open up the Bob and Sheri Archive Vault.
We're impersonating our parents this morning on the show, and it would not be a complete hour if our buddy Lamar did not join the conversation. Hi, Lamar.
Hey, how y'all doing?
We're doing fine.
I lived, when I got married and moved away from home, I lived about 90 miles away. And so we'd try to go down to visit maybe once a month or so. But it would never fail every Sunday morning, and we didn't have caller ID. So the phone would ring, and I'd pick it up, and it would be my mama. And she'd go, hello? And I'd say, hey, Mom, what are you doing? Sitting here looking out the window thinking y'all might be driving up. I said, well, Mama, the fact that you're talking to me and I'm still laying in the bed 90 miles away, she goes, I know, but I was just hoping. What's your plans for the day? And this conversation would go on for probably 30 or 40 minutes.
And if you didn't have any really concrete plans, which sometimes you don't on a Sunday, it was like,
man,
you have no reason not to be there with your mama.
Man, I was coming up with, I was having heart surgery. The house was on fire. I mean, it would just be, and after a while, I'd be sitting there. If I was sitting in the living room, I'd be sitting there, and I'd just start sinking down in the chair. And my wife would be sitting across the thing, and she'd be dying laughing because I'd just start sinking down in the chair. Sometimes while I was talking to her, I'd take my hands out, would act like I was hooking up TNT to my chest, and I'd push the plunger. I'd take my hand, and I'd make my finger out like a pistol, and I'd pull the trigger to my head, and it wouldn't go off, and I'd keep spinning it like I was playing Russian roulette. I mean, this happened, and she'd get another end going, I hadn't been feeling all that good. I mean, there was, and here's the next thing. About halfway through the conversation, she'd go, you remember Betty Ann? I go, yeah. Goes, she got cancer. There was never a good news phone call.
Oh, my God. You have that image of her going, I'm looking out the window. Wait, hoping to see your face.
And I say, well, Mama, why don't you drive up here? It's so far to drive up there. I said, well, it's about the same distance from here to there, from the, you know. But it just seems so much fun.
Yeah, it's uphill.
Yeah, I mean, she would just suck the life out of me. And, you know, and it would almost be like I should just get up and go, because when I get off the phone, I have no desire to live, much less do anything else for the rest of the day.
You know, driving to from South Carolina to Georgia is quicker because it's downhill.
Yeah. And what I would do is I'd wait about 30 minutes and I'd call my brother, because he lived 90 miles in the other direction, deeper into Georgia. Uh-huh. And I'd wait about 30, 40 minutes and I'd call my brother and he'd go, oh, God, I just got off the phone with her. Because she would call us both. And so what we would try to do is we would go down the same weekend because, I'd get to see him, and we always have a lot of fun, you know, and it would be a lot of fun. And sometimes Mama would drive, we'd both get there, and she'd go, you know, it'd be better if y'all would get on opposite weekends. I said, but Mama, you got us all together. She goes, I know, but she said, next weekend, there won't be nobody here but me and your daddy. And you know he's going to be passed out in the chair.
Oh, Lord have mercy, Lamar.
I mean, she would just kill you.
Give it to us again, what you would hear, the first thing that you would hear.
Hey, what you doing, Mama? I'm just sitting here. I'm looking out the window thinking y'all might be driving up.
And you got the visual. You got the visual, don't you? She's in her house coat.
Oh, the Lord. Sad thing is, if you could call Pugsley right now, that's what he would say.
I know. That's right. It is.
It is.
Well,
it
thanks
is
for getting
awful.
Me up, Sher.
It is awful. Here's the deal. For everybody that's listening to this and you getting that same phone call, my mama's been gone for a long time, and I'd give anything if I'd have got it in the car and went a few more times. I really would.
Well, between my dog and what you just said, let's all just have a big old cry. God, give me a break, y'all.
Bye, Lamar.
God, mamas and dogs wishing that you'd come. Give me a break.
You know what? I know what she was doing, too, because I know her. She's got a pretty devious mind. She was setting this up so that when she did finally pass away, the guilt would just eat me alive. wherever she's at in heaven, if she's sitting there playing cards with some other woman that's making her kids feel guilty, she's going, oh, yeah. It's killing him, right?
That's right.
You can hear more from the Bob and Sheri archives at bobandsheri.com.
Sign up for the newsletter with Bob and Sheri exclusive articles. Sign up now at bobandsheri.com.
Okay, right now we want to turn to the venerable Washington Post. Here's the headline. For couples, sleeping apart can bring health and romantic benefits. Let me just read. When it comes to getting enough sleep, this is by Daryl Austin. When it comes to getting enough sleep, both quality and quantity matter. At least a third of Americans are not getting the recommended amount of sleep. Sleeping alongside one's partner may be sacrosanct, but not doing so may be perceived by some as a relationship on the rocks. Few things impact the quality of your sleep each night more than your sleep environment, says a professor by the name of Meyer Krieger from Yale. That includes who's sleeping beside you and how well you sleep. The problem, he says, is that many of us already struggle with sleep problems such as restlessness, visits to the bathroom, sleep apnea, and so on. And so you pass that along, these problems, to the person who is sleeping next to you. Another doctor said that he has met with thousands of couples wanting to improve their relationship, and they have found that separate sleeping arrangements from twin beds in the same room, near each other, but in the same room, but twins, to double master bedrooms has created a strengthened bond between couples. Beyond getting better sleep, Mr. Garrison said he has found that couples who sleep apart may also improve their sex life. A bed is only for two things, sleep and sex. When you crawl into bed, one of those two Pavlovian bells should go off. Pavlovian bells should go off. And I've had doctors say that to me before. They say, don't watch TV in bed. Don't read in bed. Should be for two things, sleeping and you know what. So what do you think? I think that I would have a problem sleeping in two separate beds, and I know my wife wouldn't. The only reason I think we have not moved to that is because the bed that we bought, and it is a wonderful bed, is one of those beds that split down the middle so the backs can come up separately. So she can, you know, read from her command station there and watch her TikToks, or I can just go to sleep. The downside to that is there is a split right down the middle of the bed, and that is in some ways problematic. What do you think?
Okay, I think, first one, I don't think it's anybody's business how and where you sleep inside your own home. And I could give three halves of a rotting roadside damn what anybody's opinion on anybody else's sleeping arrangements is. Thing number two, I do share a bed with my husband because I can't think of any other way to efficiently freak him out by staring at him fixedly until he wakes up and asks me what's wrong. And I don't want to have to go.
That's good for a man.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to have to come like tiptoeing through a darkened house to freak him out. I like the convenience of knowing he's right there. Thing number three, my favorite thing to do in this whole wide world is watch TV in bed. So leave me alone and mind your business. Thing number four, my bed is for sleep, sex, watching TV, and for the cats to drag weird things in and barf them up. And that's my business. That's my business. And y'all do what you do. This idea that, well, you know, my insomnia just gives me opportunities to stare at my husband and creep him out. But other than that, like, we don't have an issue. But if you do and you're going crazy because you're exhausted and he's snoring or she's up all night watching TV or whatever it is, go sleep wherever you want. And anybody that has a problem with it, send them to me and I will tell them in my most Philly way how to manage their feelings. It is nobody's business except your own. And by the way, also, who cares what those people think? Why do you even care what random people think about your sleeping arrangements?
No, I agree with you. It's and I'm over that. I could see when I read that thing, perhaps you want to have two master suites.
Oh, okay. Well, perhaps you want to pay my mortgage.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah, I know. But I remember when I visited an ex-girlfriend's parents, they were older. And they had both lost their spouses and then they met each other and they got married. But he slept in one room and she slept in the other. Now, I was in my 20s. And so, you know, my head was, once you get married, you're sleeping together forever. That's where my head was. It seemed so strange to me. I thought, wow, why don't they sleep together? Is that what happens when you get old? But now I see that I agree with this article. Listen, if it works, it might improve your love life. It might improve your sanity. That's the other thing that was in this article. You could become more sane if somebody's not driving you crazy next to you.
Let me do a little public service here because, you know, as broadcasters, we have an obligation to the communities we serve. The FCC holds us accountable to that. So let me help everyone out there that would like to have two separate master bedrooms, but you don't have the space or the money. Do what I do. It's all perception management. If I want my husband to go sleep somewhere else, I tell him, baby, the master bedroom is wherever you lay your head. Because you're the master. And then we all have a really good big laugh. And then he gets in bed and waits for me to stare at him creepily in the middle of the night.
He's living the life.
You do what works for you, and who cares what the neighbors think? And also, right. The neighbors don't think because they're so busy worrying about themselves that they're not paying any attention to you. It's Bob and Sheri.
The Fun Size Podcast, the shareable bite-sized portion of the show. Get it by texting Fun Size to 888-BOB-SHERI.
Had a little experience that has given me a lot to think about, and I'm a little worried about humanity. I think the combination of social media in general and the pandemic, I think those two things have come together to destroy what's left of any of our senses of how to act toward other people, privately or in public.
What do you mean?
Here's what made me think that. So I had a very quick in and out flight situation. So I'm at the airport, and my routine when I fly on a plane is, like, I always go to the little airport store and overpay for M&Ms or something to eat on the plane.
Right.
Like, I associate plane travel with Bloody Marys and M&Ms because that's what I do on planes. No cocktails anymore because of COVID. So I go and I'm standing there waiting to pay, and I look and it's like, oh, Raisinettes, chocolate covered raisins. I haven't had those in forever. I'm gonna get those. So I put the M&Ms back and I pick up the bag of Raisinettes. And I made note of this because it's a 5.5 ounce bag of Raisinettes. And I think $40 is about fair for that, right? It was so ridiculous.
You bet it is, right?
So I got a bottle of water and my bag of Raisinettes. And I put them down on the counter. And there's a man next to me who's picking out his own candy. He glances over and he goes, Raisinettes, those are disgusting. And I started laughing. And then he realized he'd said it out loud. And he said, I mean, you know, no offense if you like them. Well, clearly, sir, I do because I'm purchasing them to eat. I wasn't going to stuff them in my ears while I fly. So I said, yeah, no, I know a lot of people don't like them. And I walked away and all I could think was, social media has broken us. We now say out loud things that we used to just type in as a comment.
Yeah, that's true. That's I think you're right about that. We are now saying things out loud like a long retired person does occasionally, you know?
Well that's the other thing. Yeah. Social media is basically like your old cranky grandpa or grandma. Mm-hmm. Like you'll be cruising, whatever it is, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, pick your platform, right? You're scrolling it and you'll see something and your first thought will be, ooh, that's gross. And you might add it in the comments or you might just keep thinking it. But now because we've been like weirdly separated from each other, we have forgotten that we're not supposed to say out loud the things that we would tweet or put on Facebook. We have forgotten that.
Let me give you an example, a partial example. I will boil some shrimp and then I will eat it. It's a boil and then take the shell off, put some hot sauce on it and eat it. So I'm doing that, I don't know, 2 weeks ago. And Mary says, so you didn't devein it, huh? I said, it's boiled, you know, and peeled shrimp. She goes, do you know how disgusting that is? What you're eating? What's inside that shrimp? And I said, there's nothing disgusting. It's delicious. No, it's disgusting. And she walks away. So now I've got a half a pound of shrimp. And the only thing that's been implanted in my head, and it's expensive, and I love it so much. Jimmy Buffett's still walking around. He's been eating it for a long time, and it's been ruined.
And that's your wife. Now, I want you to imagine, if you're at the grocery store, you plop it down on the little treadmill thingy, and somebody goes next to you, ooh, you eat that? That's gross. It's like, hello, this is what I want to say to people. Hello, there's no screen. This isn't Twitter. We're actual human beings standing together in the same room. Like, what are you doing? But now I'm scared. Here's why I'm scared. Am I also doing this? And I don't realize that I'm doing this. Am I also saying things to people that after I walk away, they go, well, girl, that should have been a tweet. Like, are we all guilty of this?
I don't think I am. I don't think that I am. Part of it is Max's, you know, reminded me that I could get shot. So I'm a little more careful, you know, these
days.
Well,
you could.
You know.
It's not even something aggressive, Bob. It's just something that's casually rude. That's all. It's just a casual rudeness.
We got a talkback message one time, and this woman said that she had her baby in public. And this woman looked at the baby and looked up at her, and she said, that baby's really cute. But if you don't take that baby to Sunday school, he's going to hell. And then she said, she laughed. What?
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
That's all right. That's quite a moment to bring that up.
When my mother was pregnant with me, she was out doing some yard work, and there was a snake, and she killed the snake. And one of the neighbors said to her, you killed a snake while you're pregnant? That child will be marked.
Oh, my word.
My mother said, what a kook.
You know, and look at you. You were that child, and look where you are. The producer of the Bob and Sheri show.
It's really going well, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
I know that those people have always walked amongst us.
They have.
But now they aren't like an occasional thing that you experience.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's very
now
true.
I
will say, supporting that gentleman with the Raisinets. I used to eat Raisinets a lot, especially when I was a kid going to the movies. But then as I got older, I started looking at the Raisinets and that waxy cover stuff that's on each of them, you know? And I gave them up because of that.
Can I just share? Here's a fun idea if you have little kids. Raisinets and glitter make excellent reindeer poop for the front yard in the holidays. I'm just saying. Just putting it out there for you to think about.
There you go. Right there.
It's Bob and Sheri.
Congratulations, Sheri Lynch. Named one of the most influential women in radio again this year. It's Bob and Sheri.
Sometimes you'll read about like a travel destination or a fancy restaurant or a handbag or whatever. And it's so expensive that you can't even believe people live like this. And you think to yourself, well, I would like to take a private jet to a hidden island in the Caribbean, or I would like to eat at the world's best sushi restaurant or have an Hermes Birkin bag or whatever. But I have to be honest with myself. All of that would be wasted on me. I would not be able to really appreciate it. And the reason I'm saying that is I was reading an article about this restaurant in New York City. It's a sushi restaurant. It's considered one of the best sushi restaurants in the world and one of the most expensive restaurants in America. And the way that it's set up is very rich people, very Wall Street hedge fundy. So you go there and the price is... It starts at $650 per person, not including any cocktails you might have or taxes, right? Now, the tip is included. You don't tip on top of that. It's $650. That's the lowest entry level price. And there's no menu. You pay your $650 plus whatever you spend on drinks, and the chef serves you what the chef thinks you should have based on what's fresh and, you know, what, you know, whatever is like the very, very best in that moment. And it's apparently, from what I've read, it's an incredible experience. But here's the thing. Now, I know that there's a world of hurt between grocery store sushi and whatever they're serving here.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not sure that my sushi palate is sophisticated enough to comprehend $650 tuna rolls.
No.
So I just have to say that it's a fine thing that I can't go there, because I don't know that I would get out of it what somebody with a really amazing palate would get out of it. You know,
can I ask a question at this point?
Yeah.
Do we have in our country, especially, but maybe in the world, just way too many overly rich people at this point?
Well, the owner of the restaurant I'm talking about would say no, but I hear what you're saying. And it's a free market. Like if you can earn enough money to ride a giant rocket dildo to the moon, then I guess, you know, you go, boy. But
it's not just the billionaires, the obvious choices. I mean, I think you and I were discussing when I was on vacation, I was sitting at a bar in Old Saybrook, Connecticut, and this guy was on a ship, a 200-foot boat, or it might have been 150, but I mean an enormous boat that was docked right on the, I could see it from the bar, and he's like the first mate or something like that. He's having fun, you know, doing this job for a while, and we're talking about it, and I said, boy, you know, there's an old expression, if you have to ask how much it costs to buy a boat, you can't afford it. And I'd heard that just to turn a 200-foot yacht on is like, I don't know, $500 just to turn it on. He said between Fort Lauderdale, Florida, and here, which is, I don't know, 1,200 miles, we spent $40,000 on gas.
I mean, I can't imagine it. It's just as well. Like, I come from humble, stone cold broke beginnings, and you know, and now I can have a house and feed my children. But like, there was another restaurant in this article that I read about these, like where rich people go. Mm-hmm. Dinner for two costs on average about $1,000. I'm saving the name of the restaurant for last because it's an inside joke, okay? Mm-hmm. And you'll get it immediately. Not an inside joke for us, an inside joke for humanity. So dinner for two is going to cost roughly $1,000, and that's just baseline, right? And mm-hmm. I was looking at pictures of some of the food they offer. They describe their food as experimental avant-garde. And I'm looking at a picture of a barbecued snake on a bed of peas and jello. And the only way I'm getting my husband to eat that is at gunpoint. But
yeah,
this restaurant where you can't get out for under $1,000. The name mm-hmm. of it is Mini Bar. Because what's more expensive in the world than perfect. A hotel mini bar, right?
Perfect. Yeah, I love it. That's somebody with an interesting sense of humor and irony.
It's Bob and Sheri.
Hey, thank you so much for listening to the Bob and Sheri podcast and the Bob and Sheri Oddcast. We would love if you would subscribe, rate and review, and share it with a friend on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, wherever you go. And thank you again for listening.
Birthdays, holidays, promotions, there's a lot in this world worth celebrating. But nothing is worth celebrating more than knowledge that pays off. Like understanding how compound interest works, knowing how to check your investment professional's background, or figuring out your risk tolerance.
Or finally understanding those terms your friends throw around like ETF, ESG, and ICO. Learn about these investment products and more at investor.gov, your unbiased resource for valuable investment information, tools, and tips. Before you invest, investor.gov.